אוקיי. גוד מורנינג, שבוע טוב, חודש טוב. I would like to dedicate this shiur to the memory of Michael's own aunt, Sheila Games, that passed away on Friday from Corona. Her Hebrew name is Sarah Mina Bat Mordechai. זיכרונה לברכה. So I made a דברי תורה that you would learn today בלעילוי נשמתה. Okay. Our topic for today is a topic which, on one hand, is timely and speaks to a question that many people are asking themselves these days about the ability to maybe force certain medical procedures on people. But obviously, it's much more broad, much more general than just the question of vaccination, which may be on our mind. What we would like to try and explore today is the amount of autonomy that halacha permits for a patient in the health area. And this question can manifest itself in many ways. One way is the question of information, about which we spoke a little last week. So there is a question of how much information you want to share with the patient. And maybe there would be people that may hold, that may claim that it's better for the patient not to know. If a situation is dire, is severe, then maybe it would just bring him down, and that may have bad effect on his health and his ability to manage the disease. So there is a question: to what extent do you want to reveal to the patient the real graveness? Obviously, if someone just has something very, very light, very easy, then that's not a question. But we think about a situation in which people may have, chas v'chalila, may be in very grave situations. And the question is, do you prefer to share it with the person? And by that, enabling him to decide what the treatment would be, and maybe if there is a need, enabling him to prepare for maybe for departing, or you prefer to not to tell him, to cover it up, and by that maybe to let him enjoy in a better mood, maybe in his last days. Or maybe you think that if you won't tell him, he stands a better chance to recover. So these are very strong questions and not simple to answer. So that's one question about revealing information. The other question is specifically about choosing the treatment. So what happens if the patient asks for a different treatment from what his doctor thinks is the right treatment? What if he just refuses to have treatment? In these questions, in such situations, should the doctor force what he thinks is better for the patient's health on the patient? Or do we give the individual the autonomy to choose how he would be treated? So these are the questions that we want to ask. Now, as a...
Can I also have a question? There's piano music coming. There's piano music playing on the Zoom.
Just a second.
I don't know if it's supposed to be part of the presentation.
Just a second, excuse me.
Makes it sound like a soap opera.
Ezra, it's interesting because my aunt was a piano teacher, so I thought it was quite appropriate that there should be piano playing in the background.
Okay, hopefully that's what's for that. okay, so so our questions would be the questions of choosing the right treatment, refusing to accept treatment. Now, as a background, it's important to understand that in the general culture, there was a shift regarding these questions. So if we, for a second, here, in the source Dalit, that's from the writings of the very famous Hippocrates, who was, we know his the oath that the doctors take, physicians take. So he wrote many books. He was a Greek doctor living in the 4th century before CA. And as part of what he wrote the following. So that's his recommendation for a physician. So here in source Dalet, he says that one should try and fulfill his duties peacefully and in a profound manner. By, he says, ha'alamat rov ha'dvarim min ha'chole be'tipus. So you should, he says, you should try to cover as many things as you can from the patient when you treat him. So it is better for the sick person to know as less as possible. So you should try and command the patient in a good spirit and in a concrete way while trying to divert his attention from what is being done with him. So that's like the children, right? You bring a child, and there is a need for the needle. So you say to the child, look what is there. And when he's not looking, so they give him the shot, right? So that's basically what Hippocrates here is advising to the doctor to do with adults. He says, try for the patient not to understand what is going on. Sometimes he says, you have, leitim alecha lehasit, תשומת ליבו של החולה בצורה חדה, sometimes you need to somehow, as I said, divert his attention in a very sharp way. And sometimes you need just to convince him, but do not tell him nothing about his current or future situation. So that's a very, we may say, patronic way of looking at the relationship between the doctor and the patient. And for good and for worse, for better and for worse, that was the accepted point of view for many, many centuries. The doctors felt that they know best how to treat their patients, and the patient should not interfere with the medical treatment. Now, some of you may have met in certain hospitals, doctors that still hold to this doctrine, right? That they don't think that they need to share too much information with the patient. They would take care, they would do the best that is possible, and please do not interrupt with your questions or with trying to understand what is going on. That is one approach, again, very, very common, very, very common. But almost in all of the West, starting from the 50s and on, there was a shift, a systematic shift, towards the rights of the patient. And here is an example from the Israeli law. So the Israeli law is very late, it's from 96, but basically there was a demand for the doctor to explain to the patient the situation already from the 60s. Anyhow, so in 96, there was a law saying that no medical treatment would be given to a person unless there was an informed consent. So there was given an agreement from the patient after fully understanding the situation. And in order to be able to give, to grant such an agreement, obviously the person, the patient, needs to have full access to his situation and to the possible treatments that can be given, and then he would be able to choose. Maybe he would accept, 99% of the times maybe, he would accept the recommendation of the caregiver, of the doctor. But it's up to him to decide. And maybe he can ask for a second opinion. So all of that was unheard of in the ancient world. Because in the ancient world, if I'm your doctor, if you choose, you can refuse to come to me. But if you come to me and I'm your doctor, that's the end of the story. I am responsible. But things change. And as paradigms shift, and there is much more nowadays, there is much more value given to the rights of the individual and to his ability to control his own fate, which is seen today as one of the primary values, we may say, in the Western world. And in order to gain this individual freedom, we say that the patient should be given the ability to decide in an informed way about the treatment he would be given. Okay, so that's the general background that we are working on. We didn't speak anything about halacha yet. Let's see a few examples of these questions as they were asked to halachic authorities. So two questions, we see from the Radvaz, Rabbi David ben Zimra, who was a rabbi in the 16th century in Egypt. So he was asked about a sick person that said, I need a certain medication. So he wants to be treated with a certain medication, but this medication requires desecration of Shabbat. So you need to break the Shabbat, you need to do a certain melacha, a certain work on Shabbat, which is not allowed. Now the doctor says, no, he doesn't need this medication. So that's a very interesting argument. The doctor says he doesn't need this medication. The sick person says, yes, I do need this medication. Now he's a sick person and his sickness is a dangerous one. So that's a critical situation. Nonetheless, it's a critical situation. The fact that someone is in a critical situation doesn't mean that every medication would help. So what do you do in such a case? Do you break the Shabbat? There is the expert, the health expert says, there is no reason here to break the Shabbat. It won't help. Maybe it would even cause damage. But the patient himself says, no, I know that that's what I need. I feel that that's what I need. So would we break the Shabbat in such a situation? So that's not only allowing him to choose his treatment. What measure of importance do we give to his choice? A second question, also from the Radvaz. Here there was someone that the doctor told him that he should take a medication on Shabbat, which breaks the Shabbat. And he doesn't want to. Here, not because of medical considerations, but because of mitzvah considerations. He says, no, I would prefer take the risk. We know this, I mean, that's also something that is very, very common. So someone on Shabbat is injured and the Rav even will tell him, you need to go to the hospital. And the person would say, no, I can wait to Motzei Shabbat. Nothing would happen. I would have 3, 4, 5, 6 hours. So in such a case, do we force him to go to the hospital? against his will? Or do we let him choose? Again, so treatment can be chosen for different reasons. People can opt in or out of a certain treatment either because they believe that that's what they need from a medical point of view, or because they believe that's what they need from a spiritual point of view. It's very difficult to make completely distinguish between these situations. The third question, this time from 1988, from Yaakov Ariel. And here, it's about a person with diabetes. Again, a very common question. A person with diabetes, which unfortunately is causing a very severe damage to the feet. And sometimes if it becomes, how would you say, anemic, there's no blood getting in. You know what I mean. Sometimes when there's diabetes, the outcome is that no blood comes down to the end of the leg, to the feet, and then there is a need in order to prevent
poor circulation.
Yeah.
Circulation.
Yeah, there's a blood circulation problem, but it sometimes when it's not being treated correctly, it can cause very severe damage, which is called in Hebrew nemek, and just a second, give me a second, let's see. So it says necrosis. Does it make sense?
It's organs that means death.
Yeah. Okay. So when that happens, it happens usually when it's not treated in the right way, then when this necrosis appears, you must that's obviously it's a very sad situation. You must cut off the limb in order to save the body. Otherwise, it spreads. So what happens if the patient says, you know, I prefer to die than that you'd cut my feet? And that happens sometimes, especially with very old people, which say, you know what, I lived a long and happy life, and I'm not interested in becoming unable to walk and to be independent. So I would prefer to die than to have this procedure. It's a very, unfortunately, it's not a question unheard of. So the question is, do we force this person to go through the procedure that would save his life? And obviously leave him without feet. So these are the type of questions that you would like to try and answer. Now, a basic question that underlies all of these situations is the dilemma, to what extent do we see a person as a master on his own body, on his own being? Because as I hinted earlier, one of the reasons for the shift in the approach of the Western world is exactly this consideration that people in the Western world began to see each person as independent and master to his own fate. And if I'm independent, I'm an individual who is a master to my own fate, then I can make the choice. So I can make the choice if I want to accept a settlement or not. And regardless, and as long as I understand the outcome, and as long as I am able, I'm in the right mind of state. I'm not speaking about someone that is taking his life because he has some pathology. Speak about a person that made a consideration. You can argue, you can think he's correct or that he's wrong, but he's made a consideration that can, that is understandable and made a decision. So is he a master to his own fate? The Western world said yes. So he is allowed to decide if he would get treated or not, and in what type of treatment. Now in Halacha, it's not such a simple question. As a matter of fact, there is a dispute in the Gemara in Baba Kama. The Gemara says, Ika leman de amar, there are those who say that a person is not allowed to damage himself, to injure himself. And there are those who say a person is allowed to injure himself. And the Gemara brings an example that those who hold that the person is not allowed to injure himself, he is not allowed even to prevent, let's say, the Gemara speaks about someone that takes a vow to become a Nazir. So he prevents himself from drinking wine. Gemara says even that is considered a sin, an improper thing, because you prevent your body from something that maybe can help it. Now, what is the halacha? May or may not a person injure himself? The halacha is, says Rambam in Sof Zayin, אסור לאדם לחבול בין בעצמו, בין בחברו. So in the same way that a person is not allowed to injure his friend, he is also not allowed to injure himself. That seems to imply that a person is not a master to his own fate, as in the same way that I am not a master to my fellow's fate, says Rambam, and that's why I cannot injure him. In the same way, I'm not a master to my own fate, and they cannot injure myself. That's because they belong to someone else. Obviously, according to this view, we all belong to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And there is a very interesting implication regarding a complete different halacha. And that is the halacha of self-incrimination. Is one able, if I admit in court to a certain crime, is my admission alone enough in order to sentence me? And according, again, to the law as it was developed in the Western world in the last 2,000 years, and the answer is yes. The answer is yes. Not only that self-admission is acceptable, it is considered the queen of proofs. That's the best proof. If I myself admit that they made the crime, what better proof can be? But the Torah disagrees with that. The Torah says that a person cannot admit. And if he would admit to making a crime, he would not be punished for that. What is the reason why a person cannot admit? So here again, it's the same Radvaz that we read the question sent to him earlier in this year. And the Radvaz says, I hope that you see it on your screens. The Radvaz says, Gzerat HaMelechi, ואין לנו יודעים אותם. So he says it's a law by God that a person cannot admit, and we do not know the reason. But if I may, says, may give קצת טעם, a little reason, maybe an attempt to explain why admission in a crime is unapplicable according to Halacha. לפי שאין נפשו של אדם קניינו, אלא קניין הקדוש ברוך הוא. So the soul of a person, the life of a man, do not belong to him. but to God. As it says, he quotes a pasuk from Yechezkel, Hanefashot li hena. The souls belong to Hashem. Hi lekach, therefore, lo to'il lo da'ato bedavar she'ino shelo. That's why his own admission would not work, would not help. Because in the same way that a person is not allowed to kill himself, so a person is not allowed to admit of violating a law that would get him killed. Because he is not the master on his own life, to put it in line. So that's a very interesting application of the same general definition, which is that we do not, we, halacha, the Torah, Yehadut, we put limits on the autonomy of the self. Obviously, we believe in b'chira chofshit, in free choice, no question, but we put limits to the free choice. The free choice does not allow me to injure me, even if it doesn't injure anyone else. So from a liberal point of view, as long as I'm not harming anyone else, I can do whatever I want. If I'm right in my mind. Not so according to halacha. Because there is another else, a part of the human beings, and that is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and I'm not allowed to harm God. That can be said. So that taken into account, obviously also the autonomy of the patient in the health area may be much more constrained according to halacha and according to the accepted Western view. Let's begin to see some of the answers that were given. So returning to the Radvaz that we just saw, that he said that our life does not belong to us, it belongs to God. So if you remember, one of the questions that he was asked was, what happens if someone says, you know, I would prefer not to go to the hospital on Shabbat, I would stay here and wait for Motzi Shabbat. Says the Radvaz, Klala de Milta. So my rule in these questions is, Eini ro'e b'maase haze shum chasidut. I don't see any righteousness in staying at home and not driving to hospital. Ela ibud neshama. There's no righteousness here. There is only the loss of a soul, loss of life. Hi lekach, mal'itim oto bal kocho, we would force him. We would take him to hospital, we would force feed him if needed. Kofin oto la'asot ma she'amdu. And we would require and make sure that he would do what he needs according to the doctors. V'hashoel ha'reize shofech dami. He says, not only that's what we are going to do, you don't even have to ask me such questions. He says, even asking the question is bloodshedding. You should know by yourself that every act that is needed according to say, in order to save life, should be done, no questions asked. And even if the person resists, force him. You know that when a soldier is in the army and he does something stupid, which causes him an harm, an injury. So for example, when we were in training, in advanced training, we were in Ramat HaGolan. It was a very harsh winter, very, very cold. And when you drive on the tank, and it's very, very cold, and you do not take care to be properly clothed, then you can get cold bites.
Frostbite.
Frostbites, thank you. Yeah, and it happens to many because, you know, people take off the gloves in order to mend the weapons, and then they don't put the gloves back for whatever reason. and you don't even understand in a few minutes you can have some serious injury in your hand. And I had a friend that suffered such a, it was very, very inconvenient for him. And a part of the inconvenience and the pain, he also was punished by the commander. Why? Because you damaged army property. Right? Because your hand is not yours when you're a soldier. It goes to the army. And if you do not take care of it properly, then you prevent the army from using his soldier. So that is basically what the Radbaz is saying here. He says personal autonomy is very fine, very nice, but if you take something that doesn't belong to you, your life or the integrity of your body doesn't belong to you, it belongs to God. If you damage that, then we would enforce upon you to take care properly of what is God's. Now, there is a nice connection to the Shkalim. We read Parshat Shkalim this Shabbat. So Parshat Shkalim is about our obligation when Bet Mikdash existed to bring machatzit ha-shekel, a half of a shekel. Each person bring half of a shekel to the Beit HaMikdash for the sake of korbanot zibur, of the public sacrifices. So the Tosefta in Shkalim says that if someone doesn't give from his free will the machatzit ha-shekel, you are allowed to take it from him by force. So the Tosefta says, I will give you an example to explain to you why it is allowed to take by force the machatzit ha-shekel. And the example is someone that is injured in his foot. V'haya, let's read it inside. Mashal le'echad she'alta lo makah beraglo. So the mashal is to someone that has an injury in his foot. V'haya harufe kofto. So the doctor ties him up. ומחתך בבשרו, and cut his flesh, בשביל לרפא אותו, in order to heal him, against his will. In the same way, said הקדוש ברוך הוא, משכנו ישראל על שקליהם. So take the מחצית השקל even by force, if needed to. Why? Because in the end, the sacrifices that would be bought and would be brought would heal the sins of the people. So the Tosefta says, in the same way that the doctor treats someone against his will, but for his ultimate good, so in the same way we can take this machatzit ha-shekel by force, but for your real ultimate good. So that's, again, that's going very much against the accepted wisdom of the day. Because the accepted wisdom nowadays is that I am the final authority about my ultimate good. And you are not allowed, you have no standing to tell me what is my ultimate good. If I decide that someone decides his ultimate good is not to go under certain procedure, even if that would mean that his chance of survival is basically zero, that's what his decision. That's what his decision is. And as you can see here, halacha comes from a very different point of view, at least according to this post. But we should know that this approach is not completely accepted. And there are poskim authorities, halachic authorities, that made a very interesting distinction. They said that if the patient would come to ask me, I am the Rav, the patient would come and ask me what he should do, my answer would be you must treat yourself and save your life because everything that we said up till now. But if we would not do that, we as the public or as the health system, we do not hold the power to force him to treatment. So again, everyone accepts and agrees that there is an halachic requirement, one, to save his life or to treat himself properly so his life would be saved. But there is a machloket, a dispute regarding a person that chooses to disregard this obligation and not to treat himself properly. Should we, as the community, forcibly make him be treated in order to save his life? That's a machloket. According to the Radvaz we saw earlier, the answer is that yes. Not only that he is required to save his life, if he won't do so, we are required to save his life. But here I am quoting from the Minchat Chinuch, who lived in Poland in the 19th century. And he says that if someone chooses not to save his own life, I am not obligated to save his life. Just as if someone would go in the street and throw his wallet. Usually if I see a wallet on the floor, then I have an obligation of Hashavat Aveda to bring back the last object. But if someone is throwing away, then obviously I am not, it would be completely ridiculous to say that I am more obligated to save his property than he himself is saving it. So if he himself disregards his property, I am also not obligated to keep it for him. The Minchah Chinuch says the same applies also to health. If he disregards his health, then I am not more obligated than what he does. So it seems that the Minchat Chinuch held that at least regarding the question of forcing someone, we would not force a person that would refuse a treatment. Does that mean that he's allowed to refuse? He's not allowed to refuse a treatment. But there are many more halachot that we not force someone. If he doesn't do, he doesn't do. He would have to stand judgment before God after 120. But not everything is forcible by the community. So that's an interesting question. It also may be, as we would see later, that even if on principle we are able and should enforce this type of treatments, the practical implications make it impossible for reasons that we would discuss in a few minutes, meaning that the price for forcing a treatment on one person, the price of the system would be such that we may, in the long run, we would lose more lives than we would save by taking such a strategy. Let's try to explain it. One very important consideration is that we saw earlier that the Radvaz hold that we can force someone to be treated if he says, you know, because of Shabbat, I don't want to be treated. But if you remember, we began with a different question. The question we began with was someone that doesn't say that for halachic considerations, he refused treatments, but someone that refused treatment because he believed that he knows better than the doctor. So the doctor says to him, you know, you do not need this medication. And the patient says, yes, I need. I think it's a good medication. I think it would help me. So, and it is the question. Here we speak about a patient that does not refuse treatment because he wants to die, because he wants to be righteous and think that it would be more righteous if he would not desecrate the Shabbat. Here we speak about a person that thinks that he knows better than his doctor. Well, you know what? We also know these type of people, right? And should the health system comply with that? So Radva says, "Haklal ha'olem mitvarai ele." So what I, after a long analysis of the sources, he says, what the rule that seems to come up from the sugiyot that I analyzed is, the tama de lev yodea marat nafsho, shayach ben be'achila ben bitrufa. He says, we should know that, and again, I would summarize his conclusion there. He says that medicine is built on statistics. That is to say that, obviously in their times, but also in our times, medicine and giving medications and treatments. So this is a question of numbers. The doctor can tell you, you know, I know that for 85% of the patients in your condition, this treatment was extremely helpful. And another treatment for 90% was completely useless or maybe even damaging. So medicine is a science of numbers, of statistics. And in this sense, it's not completely a science. It's also an art. And here, a certain person can say, you know, I completely believe you, Mr. Doctor. That's fine. Yes, I understand that for 85%, this treatment is preferable and the other is damaging. But I am telling you, I am the individual, I am the person, I am one of the 15%. So in such a case, the doctor cannot stop him. Why? Because the doctor does not possess complete knowledge. That's important to understand. It was correct in his time, 400 years ago. It's also correct in our times. Yes, Baruch Hashem, the knowledge of health has advanced in huge leaps and bounds. But nonetheless, much is yet unknown. And if someone tells me, oh, this medication is not good for me, I understand. You tell me that it helps 99% of the people. I feel it's not good for me. Then you should accept his opinion. That's not exactly personal autonomy per se, but that is a belief that in the end, the one that knows the best about himself is the person himself. Radva says there is a qualification. The qualification is that if the doctor would say that this medication for sure would harm him, would damage him, then we would not allow that. But as long as it's a question of statistics and the patient says, I know, I feel that that is not good to me and that it is good to me, we would grant him the type of treatment he's asking for. And more than that, we would break the Shabbat for that. So even if the type of medication this person is asking for is one that we would need to break the Shabbat, and the doctor says, you know, it won't help. And the patient says, I feel it would help me. We follow the patient's request. And again, as long as it is not coming from completely nothing, as long as there is some probability to what he says, even if it's against the understanding and the experience of the health professional, of the doctor. That's the opinion of the Radva. So we see here a qualification, because we begin with saying that it's not our life or not ours. They belong to God. And that would seem to mean that we would force people into accepting treatment according to what the doctor believes is best. But we began to saw qualifications to that. One qualification was, even if we as the patients are required to choose the treatment proposed to us by the doctor, nonetheless, it doesn't necessarily mean that the doctor can enforce us into choosing this. Second qualification is that if we feel, again, as the patients, if we feel that there is a better treatment, or the specific treatment is not good for us, even if according to the doctor's experience and expertise, it is the best method of treating a certain disease, nonetheless, we are allowed to refuse the treatment or to choose some other treatment. As long as there is some probability, even by far shot, but some probability to our decision. The same is being said by the Yavetz in the 18th century. And he also says that even if there is a treatment that is considered refu'a b'duka, meaning a treatment that was tested and passed the tests, but someone refuses to accept it because he says it's not good for me. And even more if he thinks that it may harm him, says the Moruktsia, you cannot force him to take the treatment. But he qualifies this qualification and he says, but that is as long as there is some probability to the argument of the patient. But if we speak, let's say, if we speak about someone that broke his leg, and he says, no, I know that putting a gevis, help me, ibua, what is?
Gevis is cast.
Yes, thank you. So if someone says, you know, I know that cast is not good for me. Now, I hope that I am not completely mistaken, but let's imagine for the sake of the argument that cast will help 100% of the cases. Why? Because the bone is broken and you need to fix it. There is nothing here that you can make much of. It's not a question of taking a certain medication that you don't know what would happen inside your body. So it's a very simple, clear-cut case. In such a case, if that would be a question of life and death, then the doctor is allowed and maybe required to force the patient into compliance. So again, we do not get here black and white answers, but I hope that we begin to see the different considerations in play. So one consideration is that the argument of personal autonomy is very far from being decisive in halacha. Because we see our obligation to God as preceding our personal autonomy. On the other hand, we saw that it may be that while we do not see personal autonomy as a value, we do see it as a practical consideration. That is, that the person that knows best and also that usually would have his own best interests would be the patient himself. So it would make much sense to follow what the patient feels is good for him. Now, again, in 95% of the cases, it would mean following the doctor. But in such a case that the patient would decide strongly to reject the opinion of the expert, we should not force him. Why? Not because there is a value of personal autonomy, but because we should take into our consideration the very high probability that the person knows himself and knows what's good to him and what is bad to him. So that's the basics of the area that we are dealing here with. Another very important consideration is the practical consideration. What is the practical consideration I'm speaking about? So here I quote from an answer by the Igor Moshe, the Moshe Feinstein. Now he was asked regarding a patient that again doesn't want to be treated. And so the basic halacha is that if it's a question of life and death, we should force him. Why? It's because as we said, it's not his own life. He doesn't have the permission and the right to take his life in his hands because it's not his life, it's God's life. We do not, contrary to the Western belief. We do not bring ourselves into existence. We are not the gods of ourselves. We are not the creators of ourselves. Our creator is the real God, with capital G. And that is why our life belongs to him. And this interesting and beautiful idea that the person builds himself, which is one of the basic concepts of the Enlightenment, has its place. We do believe that people build themselves in the sense that we would choose. That's what the Torah calls "Achaim ve'amavet natati lefanecha hatov ve'ara uvacharta b'chaim." The Torah says you have the ability to choose between good and bad, between life and death, and you should choose good. You should choose life. So yes, in that sense, we build ourselves because we decide, we have free will and free choice. We decide who will be, but we do not decide if we will be. The mere existence, it's not to us, but to God. So, the basic law, the basic halacha, as we saw throughout this few weeks, that if someone refuses to be treated, so for example, let's attend to the question we began with, this diabetic man, that you need to procedure on his legs and Chas v'Chalila remove them in order to save the body, not to save his life. And he says, no, I'm not interested. I'm not interested. I had enough. So it seems that the simple answer would be to force him. And maybe some poskim would really say that. But the Igot Moshe is very fearful of such a decision. Why? Because he says, what would happen if we would do such a thing? If we would treat people against their will, so that would be very harmful to their ability to overcome their situation. They would almost certainly fall into a negative state of mind because they will feel that they are captured, that their life were taken from them, the most important choices of their life were taken from them. That would not lead to a healthy situation. So that in himself can cause more damage than help. I think that's a very important argument that he makes. So again, that's not so much on a principle basis, but just on a very practical basis. He says, it may be that in the past, when people were not expecting to be given this autonomy over their life, they were more susceptible to be forced take one treatment or another. But nowadays, if you do such a thing to a person, he would feel that you have captured him. That he's in captive. That his life were taken from him. That would damage his chances of survival. More than that, what would happen if people will know that by going to the hospitals, they forfeit their ability to choose their treatment? Many people may avoid going to the hospital. Because they would say, we do not want to be treated against our will. So in the long run, you may cause more death. You'd maybe save the patient that is in front of you. But in the long run, when we speak about the health system, we speak about millions of people. So our considerations should be very wide. Says the Igot Moshe, so what should be done is to try and convince him. And we should maybe invest a lot of resources into that. So bringing more doctors, maybe bringing psychologists that would speak with him. and try to explain to him what is, if that's something that speaks to him, then speak to him what is the halacha. If that doesn't speak to him, then try to convince him with whatever means that that would be helpful, it would be useful. But says the Gut Moshe, it is very rare that you'd find a situation in which treating someone against his will would end up with more gains than losses. Usually, if you treat someone against his will, it will be more of a loss than of a gain. That's his basic argument. So again, if we return to the questions that we began with about personal autonomy, it's important to understand that halacha does not grant, and that's an ideological difference. Halacha does not grant the same amount of personal autonomy, of ideology of personal autonomy, as the Western world. But it may be that on practical grounds, the difference would not be very great. So if someone would ask me, am I allowed to choose a treatment that is not good to me? The answer would be no. Halachically, you must accept the opinion of the doctor and go according to it. But would we force someone? Many times we would not. We didn't speak here today about the whole question, as I said, of vaccinations. Because there is one more element that is being brought in, and that is that my decision does not affect only myself, but may also affect others, which of course completely change the whole arena. And I think that we already had one shiur about vaccination, so I would not give another shiur about it. I would only say that the bottom line seems to be that you cannot force someone, according to halacha, to vaccinate. Meaning you cannot force in the sense that you cannot capture him and give him the shot against his will. But what you are completely allowed to do is not to allow him into a public buildings. You are allowed to prevent his children if there is no other way. That's a very severe move, but if there is a need, you are allowed to prevent his children from learning in school. So you are allowed, the society is allowed to protect itself from people that may cause it damage or harm. Now, it basically boils down to more or less forcing him into getting vaccinated, because it would be very difficult for him to live to a normal life without being vaccinated. But that is not exactly as taking someone and vaccinating him against his will. So these are a big debate, but it seems to be where the halacha is landing. Okay, so I hope that we were able to clarify some of the subject that we were speaking about today. Obviously, it's a very wide and complex subject, and each and every question should be dealt separately. But what was very important for me is to try to emphasize the difference between the principle here, and the principle here is that we are obligated to the God that gave us life, and that's a gift that we are obligated to keep. And on the other hand, on practical grounds, it doesn't mean that we can force people here and there to take whatever treatment the doctor says is correct, because many times, A, they know themselves better than what the doctor knows, and they may know more than what the doctor knows, and B, that even if we are sure that a certain treatment would help this specific patient, it may be that in more broad consideration, forcing people to get treatments would cause, in the end, more damage than benefit. And with that, let's hope that all of that would remain only theoretical, and everyone would stay in good health. And Bezat Hashem, we should have a good week and a healthy and happy month.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rav.
Bye.
Bye.